Grace Community Baptist Church. We're glad you came back to watch another streaming service here. We look forward each and every week to talking to you about Jesus. And speaking of Jesus, Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father but by me. If you don't understand who Jesus is or what he's all about, we would love to talk to you about the person of Jesus Christ, to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. We're going to be having a few more streaming sessions, and we believe even after we start back in our church, we'll continue to do this just so that folks can feel comfortable, whether at home or here at the church. We look forward to praising God today with you. Thank you for watching our service today.
Today is the day we put aside to remember fallen heroes and to pray that no heroes will ever have to die for us again. They chose to reject the fashionable skepticism of their time. They chose to believe and answer the call of duty. They stood for something. And we owe them something.
Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We must realize that no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. With God's help, we can and will resolve the problems which now confront us. And after all, why shouldn't we believe that? We are Americans.
At the grave of a hero, we end not with sorrow at the inevitable loss, but with the contagion of his courage, and with a kind of desperate joy, we go back to the fight.
Invite you every Wednesday night to join us on our Zooming event. If you would like to be a part of that, please contact the church or just email us. Those emails are on the streaming site. They come up every once in a while. We would love you to be a part of going to our Lord with our prayers and our concerns and our praises. Speaking of that, let me update you on a few of those. As you know, maybe you have not heard, President Trump deemed churches and other places of worship as essential. We praise God for this. That means we're moving toward opening up our churches and fellowshipping and praising God together once again. Keep us in prayer as we seek wisdom from Father God on how we are to do that. Please keep Robbie Zacharias' family and in your prayers as they mourn his passing. This has had an effect on the whole world. Robbie was a minister who preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and did it wonderfully. But he died of cancer this past week. Please keep the Deming family in your prayers. Dan and Carol and the rest of the family. Dan's mother passed away. And Cassie, my daughter-in-law's grandmother, I believe she was 98 years old. But we know where Fritz is at, and we praise God for that. We've also praised God for a couple of donations made to Base 215 in the past weeks. They believe one was $230 and one was $400. We praise God for that because this goes to help children young people in the local community through whether it be a pool tournament, whether it be going to church camp, going to a concert, all these different things to help our youth here in Trenton and in New Bay, in the New Memphis, where they might be coming from. Other prayer requests we have this morning, Michael Feld and Corey Bohoffer are both graduates, one from Westland High School and one from SIUE. We praise God for that, and we look forward to seeing great things from them. Speaking of Michael, he signed to play baseball with University of Wisconsin
Stout.
That's it. And what a wonderful thing for him to do that. The Gazelle, this is a new streaming event from Base 215. Elder Alan Zerlini is leading that, and that's on YouTube and I believe Facebook. And if you have not heard about that, that'll be posted as well during this streaming. Ryan Ottensmeyer, he has gotten a job in San Diego, and he is settling in and doing well. We praise God for that. We've been praying for him for about a month, and we just thank, praise God that he's doing well out there. We want to continue to pray for Jordan Ledbetter, Clinton County Deputy Sheriff, who was in an auto accident. We want to continue to pray for our streaming services and all that's going on with that. The transformation and revival for America. I don't know if you've seen it, but I've seen it. There's been a lot of talk on Facebook, a lot of talk on YouTube, all these different places, Snapchat even, and people talking about Jesus more and more. And that just warms my heart because people are turning back where they need to be turned for comfort, for peace, and for encouragement. Our sister, Linda Weekly, she had a doctor's appointment with her eye doctor this past week and said it'll just take some time for that to heal. But she is having some, she's got a neurologist appointment hopefully here in the next month. Continue to pray for her and her healing. We'll pray for the Guatemala missions trip. We're hopeful that they'll be able to go back in August. They were supposed to go this month, but they, of course, they had to reschedule it. Just continue to pray for them and the planning for they'll have to do for that. Of course, our COVID-19 cases and in Clinton County, Clinton Manor especially, they've been hit pretty hard. I continue to pray for those folks and those who are caring for them and those all over the world as we fight this virus. Pray for Fran for wisdom. Also pray for her brother, Steve, as he's home recovering from a gallbladder surgery. We also want to lift up Dr. Elvira Saladaro, as a friend of Gina's, has been hospitalized with COVID-19 in St. Elizabeth. So keep them in your prayers. And Elvira is the lady, and her husband, Freddie. And Rich Fritz is a dear brother of ours here in the church, and he is having some shoulder problems and some wrist pain from arthritis. And Kaylee Jones, we've been praying for her for some time. Please keep her in your prayers as well. Let us go to Father God in prayer. Father God, it is good to be in your house today. It's good just to come together, whether it be through a video or streaming, or those who are here right now. Father, we just lift up your holy name, and we praise you, and we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you are the one true living God, and that we can come to you day or night, and you hear our prayers. Father, whether it be through a Zooming event on a Wednesday night, or right here, or in our homes, or our prayer closet, in our cars, wherever we might be, we're talking to you. You hear us, and you answer our prayers. It might not always be the way we want them answered, but you answer them. We thank you for watching out for us. So we pray for protection upon our first responders and those who are dealing, our doctors or nurses, or CNAs or LPNs, all those who are dealing with this COVID-19 virus. Father, we know that you are in control. You're in charge of what is going on. And we look to you in all things. We give you all glory. And Lord, we don't live in fear. We live knowing that you're going to take care of us. You're going to watch over us. And you're going to keep us. Father, I just pray today, as we've mentioned all these prayer concerns, that you'll touch and be with every one of these families, Lord. Robbie Zacharias' family, the Heming family. Lord, be with President Trump as he makes huge decisions for our country. Lord, be with our governor and the governors of all the other states, Lord, that they will make the right decisions for the people. And Lord, be with us as a church. Give us wisdom, Lord, to do the right things when we do open our doors. Lord, we ask for protection most of all. Father, be with our pastor now as he comes to bring the message. Lord, just pray your Holy Spirit will work through him. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Bob Marsh, and we want to welcome you this morning as we worship the Lord together in this live stream production from Grace Community Baptist Church. We want to thank many of you for your prayers, and we want to thank you for your encouragement over the last days and weeks. I think we're into our seventh or eighth week of doing live streaming. We want to thank Fran and Brandon for their behind-the-scenes work to make this all possible. Before we look at God's Word this morning, I do want to share with you some good things. Mike mentioned gifts that were given to Base 215 recently, and how encouraging is that? One of them was for Bibles. The other one was just for the programming that goes on. All of this is going to be used for the young people that we touch down at our community youth center that we run. We also want to remind you that on Tuesday, the day after Memorial Day, our summer snack pack program begins. And so Monday through Fridays, young people and their parents can come by and get a sack lunch between the hours of 11:30 to noon from the Base 215 Youth Center that we run on 215 East Broadway. We want to encourage you to come. We've changed some things this year. People won't be going inside. They'll just drive through and they'll be handed the number of lunches that they need. And we're trying to keep everybody safe and protected during this COVID-19 pandemic. Well, this morning, we want to use as our text John 15:13, in which we read this: "Greater love has no man than this, to lay down his life for one's friends." Let's pray. Father, we ask that you be with us this morning as we speak about your word. Lord, lead us, guide us, direct us. Father, encourage us, strengthen us. If there's anyone here today that is asking a lot of questions about you and about your son, Jesus, Lord, I pray you will speak directly to them as well. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's 3 a.m. on a cold winter day. Patchy snow covers the landscape as loudspeakers overhead blare, telling everyone to get to their places. Surrounded by sandbags, concrete barriers, and roughly 10,000 soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines, Bagram Air Base has flipped the switch and turned from a deployed city in sleep to a sea of green and tan military awaiting further directions. Some just woken from a few moments of sleep, others leaving their duties to attend to more pressing concerns, all focused on the events that are about to unfold. Down the 3-mile main road of this Afghanistan base, standing shoulder to shoulder, men and women in arms, waiting to pay their respects to a fallen comrade. Soon the lights of emergency vehicles can be seen slowly making their way up the boulevard, escorts leading a flatbed trailer to a waiting C-17 cargo plane on its way back to the United States. On the trailer are 3 caskets draped in U.S. flags. As the trailer approaches the lines, or our servicemen are lining the streets, each pays their respects by saluting sharply, and the men and women who have paid the ultimate price. Once the trailer reaches the plane, the formation is dismissed. Thousands of servicemen in the middle of a war zone, paying homage and respect the best way they know how. Similar ceremonies are played out in other parts of the world, all to show the love and respect for the sacrifices and dedicated duty of our military servicemen and women, shown on a daily basis. Memorial Day is about remembering these fallen heroes and honoring their sacrifices on our behalf. Claudia Pemberton wrote, "America without her soldiers would be like God without his angels." John Thune wrote, "I believe our flag is more than just cloth and ink. It's a universally recognized symbol that stands for liberty and freedom. It is the history of our nation, and it's marked by the blood of those who died defending it." Will Carleton wrote, "Over all our happy country, over all our nation spread, is a band of noble heroes is our army of the dead. Joseph Campbell wrote, "A hero is someone who has given his or her life to something bigger than oneself." And Eleanor Roosevelt wrote, "Freedom makes a huge requirement of every human being. With freedom comes responsibility." So, what is the history of Memorial Day? Memorial Day is an official holiday in the United States. It was observed on May 30th until 1971, when for federal employees, the date was changed to the last Monday in May. The custom of placing flowers on the graves of the war began on May 5th, 1866, in Waterloo, New York. And Waterloo has been recognized by Congress as the official birthplace of Memorial Day. In 1868, General John Logan, then the president of the Grand Army of the Republic, declared that May 30th would be a day to decorate the graves of comrades with flowers who died in defense of their country during the late rebellion. After World War I, the day was set aside to honor all Americans who died in wars. Then the custom was extended to pay tribute to deceased relatives and friends, both military and civilian. The most solemn ceremony conducted on Memorial Day is the placing of a wreath on the tomb of the unknown soldier located in Arlington National Cemetery. Tomorrow, we celebrate this day. Many people see it as just a day off, a three-day weekend, a reason to cook out and invite friends over. But for those who have lost somebody because of war or military action, it means much more than a day off. In fact, every American ought to recognize this day and honor those who gave their lives to make America what it is today. Free, strong, and a nation worth fighting for. Because men and women have died for this country, we have the right to preach God's word freely. We have the right to live at peace in our own homes. We have the right to pursue peace and prosperity and happiness. We need to thank God for those who died to make us free. Now, there's three things that we normally would do on Memorial Day. One, we mourn the loss. Secondly, we remember the lives. And third, we are thankful for the sacrifice. As we prepare today to remember those who died for our country, it's important to remember the one who died to set us free from our sins. Jesus fought the armies of hell so that we might have liberty in his name. Every week is a celebration of the memorial of Christ. Every Sunday is a memorial day for the Christian. In light of Christ's battle, let's take a closer look at our memorial in him as we recognize the likeness of our celebration of our military. On Memorial Day, we mourn the loss. On Memorial Day, we remember the lives. And on Memorial Day, we are thankful for the sacrifice. One example of such sacrifice was made by Pat Tillman. Pat Tillman was a professional football player for the Arizona Cardinals, who chose to leave that life of luxury behind him and join the U.S. Army. Pat eventually joined the Special Forces and found his way into battle in the Afghanistan countryside. Pat also paid the ultimate price. Also, this past week, on Monday, I read where the New York Times reported a doctor who delayed his retirement to fight the coronavirus during this pandemic at a low-income hospital who died of COVID-19. Pulmonologist James Mahoney worked his day shifts in the intensive care unit of the University Hospital of Brooklyn, which, like many hospitals in New York, initially lacked the medical equipment needed to treat the onslaught of coronavirus patients during the pandemic. Mahoney, who was 62, had the option of retiring after serving for over 40 years as a physician, but instead, he treated patients until he contracted the virus and died on April 27. Dr. Mahoney had also treated patients during the AIDS epidemic, the 9/11 attacks, and Hurricane Sandy, and he refused to step away. Dr. Mahoney also worked night shifts at nearby Kings County Hospital Center, and he conducted telemedicine sessions with his regular patients during the pandemic. During the second week of April, he reportedly told his boss in a text that he had a fever, but he continued to consult patients while he was isolated at home. He was eventually admitted to University Hospital's emergency room on April 20th when he could barely walk. On April 26th, his colleagues took him to Tisch Hospital, which had a blood oxygenation machine that the University Hospital did not have. Five colleagues followed the ambulance to the hospital and were with him when he died. There are many, many, many more such stories like this, but the picture is clear. Many men and women have put their lives in extreme danger for their comrades in arms, and in some cases gave their lives in order that others might live. It seems in every war, in every battle, almost without exception, such heroic actions occur, sometimes from individuals you would least expect. I have no doubt that each time in the days and weeks that followed, the recipients of such unselfishness were inspired to fight for their wounded or fallen comrades, perhaps with greater zeal than ever before. I want to share with you one other illustration. It was a few weeks before Christmas in 1917. The beautiful snowy landscape of Europe was blackened by war. The trenches on one side held the Germans, and on the other side, the trenches were filled with Americans. It was World War I. The exchange of gunshots was intense. Separating them was just a very narrow strip referred to as no man's land. A young German soldier attempting to cross that no man's land was shot and become entangled in the barbed wire. He cried out in anguish, and then in pain he continued to whimper. Between the shells, all the Americans in that sector could hear him scream. When one American soldier could stand it no longer, he crawled to that German soldier. When the Americans realized what he was doing, they stopped firing, but the Germans continued. Then a German officer realized what the young American was doing, and he ordered his men to cease firing. Now there was a weird silence across the no man's land. On his stomach, the American made his way to the German soldier and disentangled him. He stood up with the German in his arms and walked straight to the German trenches and placed him in the waiting arms of his comrades. Having done so, he turned and started back towards the American trench. Suddenly, there was a hand on his shoulder that spun him around. There stood a German officer who had won the Iron Cross, the highest German honor for bravery. He jerked it from his own uniform and he placed it on the American, who walked back to the American trenches. Only when he had safely returned to the trenches did they resume the insanity of war. The German soldier was thankful for that American soldier's sacrifice. On Memorial Day, we mourn the loss. We remember the lives, and we are thankful for the sacrifice. In a small Middle Eastern country over 2,000 years ago, that's exactly what happened. A closer look at this hero reveals some strong similarities to the heroes I just described, but also some significant differences. His name was Jesus, son of Joseph, the carpenter. He was raised in Nazareth. The scriptures give us little or nothing to go on about his early life other than the familiar Christmas story, the visit of the Magi, and the time when he stayed behind at the temple and his parents came to find him. After that, there's a significant jump ahead in time to his adult life and his ministry among both his people, the Jews, and the many Gentiles as well. Who would have expected such heroic action from this man? The prophet Isaiah tells us that there was nothing about him physically which would have hinted at the possibility of any heroics. not like the way we would like to picture our heroes. Like so many heroes of our present day, he too gave of himself. To begin with, Jesus put himself in harm's way. He endured pain and suffering for the benefit of others. In Isaiah 53, this was foretold far in advance. We read, "Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed." And he did it willingly, as Isaiah continues. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. Matthew records in his gospel not once but twice that Jesus responded to the pain and suffering he was about to endure with the words, "Not my will, Father, but yours be done." It's at this point where our comparison falls short. The men and women of military put their lives in danger for the sake of their fellow soldiers against other human beings. The battle Christ waged was against something far more powerful and devastating. The ultimate victory was not simply the taking of some important hilltop or body of water or even one country over another, but one which secured our very souls. The victory over the power of the devil and of sin in our lives, and ultimately the victory over death. Let's read just a little more of this hero. In John chapter 11, we read about Lazarus and Jesus coming to him. Verse 17, it says, "Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, 'Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you.' Jesus said to her, 'Your brother will rise again.' Martha said to him, 'I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day.' Jesus said to her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?' She said to him, 'Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world.'" Now, if you know the rest of the story, Jesus goes and resurrects Lazarus from the dead. Listen, some of you are like Lazarus today. We need to have our lives resurrected from the dead too. Some of us have already had our lives resurrected from the dead like Lazarus. We want our lives to count. We want our days to matter. We want to make a difference. We want to have meaning and purpose in the lives we live. We want to live and, yes, even die for a greater purpose than ourselves. Are you willing to acknowledge, right along with Martha and millions of others, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world"? Then give your heart to Jesus today and allow him to resurrect and shape your life into something eternal that will bear fruit. Begin now to let him build in you the kind of legacy that will go before you and follow you right into glory. But Pastor Bob, you don't know my past. But dear one, you don't know my past. But Jesus does, and he is willing to love you into eternity and to forgive you of your past sins if only. If only you call on his name and confess your sins to him and receive his salvation and forgiveness today. Tomorrow, as we mourn the loss of our dead, and we remember the impact that they had on our lives, and as we are thankful for their sacrifice, let us be sure to thank God Almighty for the gift of his Son Jesus and his life lived here in sacrifice for all of us who would believe and receive. who would trust and believe in his shed blood at Calvary, so that we might spend eternity and live life now to the fullest in his purpose and service. In Jesus' name, amen.